Beach FM, locals talking to locals.
Beach FM, great to welcome back our man with an eye on the island and in fact other matters, Karl Webber. A very good morning and welcome to you.
Morning, John.
Lovely to talk to you. And, well, we've got some developments on the Gateway project since last we talked. Government money has come through. It apparently came from the Shovel Ready project money, not the Provincial Growth Fund. And from my point of view, this Gateway project is far from shovel ready.
Yeah, I'd probably agree. John, I think council was lucky to get the funding through from that, especially that there's been such a lot of opposition from the community to it.
Indeed, there's a few more numbers that have, in fact, in what they call the indicative business case that supported the application has been published yet, and there's quite a few assumptions there. One of the ones, Karl, that really got me was one of the key variables to inform the indicative business case was there's going to be no allowance made for the repayment of capital. And that's extraordinary at any project. I would have thought that you'd have to allow something to repay the loan.
There's a lot of stuff in there that doesn't sort of ring right to me. It doesn't feel right. To be honest, I haven't gone and dissected the application and what council have just come out on their website. A lot of people are talking about it, and Stuart McDonald and a couple of others did a pretty good... They did their own sort of business analysis of that and sent it to all the elected members. So I know there's a few different bits of information and conversation going on around us, and it's going to be interesting to see how it all sort of pans out.
What's your feeling for how the public mood is over the Gateway Centre? Because there has been an enormous amount of information that has been published, a lot of views have been put forward. How do you think it's trucking along?
I think it's still kind of where it was sort of a while ago, where people don't feel they're being listened to, and a lot of people aren't happy about this. I haven't heard very many people say that they do support or happy about this, apart from some of our council elected and also some of the council staff. So yeah, I don't think the sentiment's changed. My opinion is about 70% of people out in social media land are pretty much against this, and would like to see other options explored and further discussion. But I don't think people feel like they've been consulted or engaged over this. And I think part of the concern is that council seem to think that they have done that. So. It's interesting.
Well, the mayor told me the council was beginning to do it properly. He agreed that the consultation was inadequate, but on the day that the application was approved, he was telling me that was when the community consultation would begin. Have you felt any consultation happening? I mean, you're well connected in the community, Karl. Have you heard of any extra consultation?
Not yet. I think what we've seen is a marketing and propaganda type strategy from council, that's I think what the business case is. They're trying to cobble together something to justify this without actually going back to what the core issue is. And the core issue for me, and I think for a lot of people, is that there's two things going on here. There's a visitor information sort of centre. Mm-hmm. We're also looking at a biosecurity facility for the island. Is it the Kapiti Island Gateway? Is it the Kapiti Coast Gateway? Kapiti Island Gateway, so for the limited numbers that go there, yep, we do need something there. This is way over the top in my and many other people's opinion. For a visitor centre information type facility for the Kapiti Coast and the visitors that are coming to the Kapiti Coast, we really need a discussion about, where would be a good place to have that, what would be a good thing to look like. And there's plenty of other options, but they seem to have been cut out. I think I might have said that last time, but it's just going to be a very narrow focus discussion, and somebody's driving somebody's agenda, I believe.
One of the assumptions in the business case is that the biosecurity area is going to be staffed by volunteers, by the way, which I find quite surprising. I would have thought that was an area where you should have professional staff doing the very important biosecurity work to look after the island.
Yeah, same. And I think if you look at other biosecurity things that happen around New Zealand, they're very, very strict and stringent on what they do. And Kapiti Kapiti really does need that, and it's a level one biosecurity sanctuary. I think Kapiti and Little Barrier might be the only two in New Zealand, so we do need something there, but I think we need to get real about the numbers. You know, so the numbers that are being pushed, in my opinion, and also in one of the ferry operators, the other operator's opinion, they don't stack up. You know, there's only a certain amount of people you can put on a ferry and take them back and forth to the island on any given day, regardless of what the cap on numbers is. And then, you know, they don't take into account 3 months of the year that the everybody's off season. You know, dock kind of closed down, the ferries stop operating, and they do all their maintenance and go on holidays. And then in the other 9 months of the year, you've got, you know, you get rough weather sailings and things like that go down. So when the council's figures are saying, you know, that the 25% of capacity, it's actually just about at capacity for what can actually physically and logically happen. But it seems like council don't want to hear reality checks. They just want to push this project regardless because they've got the money. And I understand that. I mean, we've got $2.5 million sitting there. It's going to be really hard for people not to sort of want to take the bag of lollies.
Indeed. It's interesting you mentioned that you think the island is close to capacity, because one of the other assumptions is that the growth rate for visitors to Kapiti Island will be 12.5% per annum. Do you think that's realistic or not?
No, not at all. You know, I'd be listening to what Glenn and Vicky Cooper are saying. You know, those guys know they're running a charter boat. And, you know, we all know Mark and Jenny Fraser, who ran it before that.
Yes.
And Ross Ledger, who ran it before that. And, you know, some of us actually know how this works. And what's being talked about won't work. So and the council need to come and talk to the key people that do know this stuff and actually listen to them. You know, there's a difference between hearing what people say and listening to them. And I just don't think people are being listened to. Really what I want, John, I just want our elected members to hurry up and go and vote on this, to vote yes to go ahead or vote to no go ahead, so that, that we can get on with our lives, or we can, you know, we can sort of take another step to this, because, you know, people are taking a lot of time and effort out of their lives to keep sort of trying to keep this on track where it needs to go, and it's still not in the right direction. In
That's
my
right.
opinion.
And they're volunteering that time, by and large, you know, as you say, they want to go and live their lives, and this can take an enormous amount of effort. And I think that often free labour, as any volunteering and any consultation workers, that is taken for granted, I think, by some of the people in authority. That really intensely annoys me. Karl, just before we go, what's your impression about the airport in terms of the unity within the iwi, within the hapu, within the pukatapu hapu? Do you think there is a united view of the hapu in terms of the airport?
Yeah, so I'm privy to a little bit of information around this. So I do know that the pukatapu hapu, you know, they're all moving forward collectively about their thoughts and things around the airport. They do have a treaty settlement coming up at some stage in the next year, I think. So,
yes.
You know, hopefully they will have some resources. And I do know it's early days, but I do know that members of the pukatapu hapu have connected with the new owners of the airport, and so they're starting to build a relationship. So, you know, so that's really cool. From my angle, I'd love to see the original owners get the airport land back and be able to do what they want to do with that. I don't know if the treaty wall settlement will allow that, and I don't think National or Labor, I don't think central government have a desire to purchase the airport. So I don't know, but what is cool is that, yeah, Pukatapu Hapu, those guys are a united group, and they have started a relationship with the new owners of the airport. So hopefully, you know, that's a good starting point with their conversation. And, yeah, I suppose, you know, they'll sort of bring some conversation out public when they're ready to, but, yeah, it's probably early days for that.
Karl Webber, you've been once again a mine of information. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. You are always welcome here on Beach FM. Thank you for your company this morning.
Kia ora, John. Always my pleasure, man.
106.3 Beach FM.